Look up, Indy.
My
If you're like me, you're constantly carrying this kind of a camera around, even when you're on vacation, if you're at Disneyland, it doesn't matter where you are, you're always carrying a camera because you want to make the best pictures possible. What I want to do is help you with that process. When you're taking pictures of people, I'm going to walk you through some of the things that I think about every time I take a photograph of a person so that you can get better shots of your people and your life wherever you happen to be. First, I'm always going to look for an interesting location. We found one. It's here in Chandler, Arizona at a train museum. Second, I'm going to look for great light. And that's really, really important. You can't just take a picture of a great location. You have to have great light. Third, once I've got that lighting and I've got that exposure correct, then I'm going to start composing my shot. I'm going to make sure that I'm composing it with basic rules, for instance, like the rule of thirds. Then I'm going to start to watch what happens in front of me. I'm going to look for expressions. I'm going to look for moments. And that's where the fun really begins. So let's go through those and I'll show you how I think about photographs every time I'm taking a picture of a person, whether it's professionally or just at the train museum with my family and friends. So the first thing that I need to do is start looking for light. So I look here and I naturally see one big problem with all the light that's around me, and that is that it's a very harsh sun because it's noon. It's not in the sweet light of the day, in the morning, or in the evening. And depending on where you place your subject, you can either have them squinting in the sun, you can have light coming from the side, and it's creating hard shadows across their noses, and they just don't look all that great. So we're going to look for shade. Now in this case, because the sun is directly overhead, there's very little shade on this location. So what I'm looking for is shade that I can create. And that's simply turning them away from the sun. You can see that Devin and Indy both, because they're turned away from the sun, have created their own shade. Their face is in the shade of their own body, which means there are no harsh shadows. And as a bonus, we get this beautiful rim of light all the way around their hat and on their hair and on their shoulders, which helped separate them from the trains in the background, which incidentally, the trains in the background have the same advantage because they are faced away from the sun. The sun is beyond them, and so they have the same shade that Indy and Devin have, which means that when I photograph Indy and Devin, they are exactly the same exposure, which is going to make my next job that much easier. When I'm looking at exposure, there are three things that I need to have my camera set to make sure that I know that the exposure is correct. The first thing that I want to do is make sure that I'm always looking at my histogram when I'm confirming my exposures. So you can turn that on any camera today, and it's always going to show up when you hit the play button on your camera. Secondly, I'm going to make sure my highlight warnings are on. That means that every time it shows your exposure, it's going to blink if there's a severe overexposure. And the third thing is that I'm going to make sure that my camera is in a manual mode and also has the spot metering option turned on. My metering system is only going to register the very, very center spot inside of my camera. So when I look at Devin, Devin's face is registering dead on in the center of my light meter, which means that it's middle gray. Her face is perfectly exposed for a middle gray exposure. So I know that I'm right in the zone where I want to be. And if I point that circle at her dress, it's actually darker than the center, which is perfect. That's where it should be. So I know I kind of am in the right spot. So I'm going to take a picture really quickly. All right, girls, I'm taking a photo of you. If it was underexposed, we would see that these piles of information in the histogram would be far to the left and they would start clipping on the left. And if it was way too overexposed, we would see those piles piling up on the right-hand side of the histogram. Fortunately for us, we have the highlight warnings on, And we can see that it's only blinking in the sky, which we're okay with letting it go. For this image, we're shooting at 100 ISO, and the reason we're at 100 ISO is we want to keep the image as clean as possible. So the lower the ISO, the cleaner the image is gonna be. The higher the ISO, the more grain and noise you're gonna get. So we're keeping it at 100 ISO. The f-stop is at 4.5. Now, the f-stop deals with your aperture. That's the size of the hole that the exposure is going through. So the higher the number, the more focus you have. The smaller the number, the less focus you have. I want to kind of be in a sweet spot. I want to have enough focus so that I can focus on Devon and Indiana at the same time. But I don't want so much depth of field that the trains are sharp as well. The shutter speed is at 1/400th of a second, and the reason that I've chosen 1/400th of a second is because I'm hand-holding a long lens. Now, if you've ever been in a situation where you took a picture and everything has motion blur, even the lamppost, which should be absolutely still, that's because you were moving your camera and your shutter speed was too slow. So the faster the shutter speed, the more it can stop action. The slower the shutter speed, the more you have blur. 1/400th of a second is a pretty good safe bet for a situation like this where people aren't moving too fast and you can stand fairly still, but you can still hand hold something. If I was photographing sports or if I was a little bit more shaky, then I would want to increase the shutter speed to say 1/1000th of a second or even higher to make sure that I wasn't getting motion blur. So we're at 1/400th of a second at f4.5 at 100 ISO. And now we can compose and really focus on how the shot's going to look.